Hey everybody, thanks for joining us for the second in our hopefully many part series on power regulation and power regulators in your PCB. I'm Zach Peterson, I'm a technical consultant with Altium, and today we're gonna get into a little bit deeper on LDOs. So if you watched the last video, we kind of introduced some of the basics of power regulation in your board, starting with AC input power, what happens with rectification and filtering, and then producing some DC output with ripple. Now, after that happens, you need to re-regulate that down to some stable DC output to then supply to your components. How do you do it? You need a power regulator. And sometimes when you need to supply multiple voltage levels in your system, maybe you have a digital system with multiple logic levels, then you'll need multiple regulators and you'll need to figure out a strategy to be able to do that. So what I'm gonna do today is we're actually gonna dig into some data sheets and we're gonna look at some application diagrams and we're gonna show exactly what happens in these different components and we'll go over some of the specs in a data sheet and what you can expect when you use an LDO in different ways. Let's get into it. So an LDO operates with a specific amplifier circuit, and it's based entirely around this amplifier circuit. This particular amplifier circuit is called an error amplifier. And you will probably never need to build one of these into your circuit board because, hey, it's already built into your LDO. So inside of an error amplifier, it's basically an op amp that works with a specific voltage called a reference voltage. In this operational amplifier circuit, essentially what happens is we have our input voltage connected to a FET, and then on the output from this FET, we have a pair of feedback resistors. You can already see where this is going, hopefully. As we complete this feedback loop, we're wrapping all the way around to this positive input. So we've created a positive feedback loop involving these two feedback resistors. The voltage reference plus the feedback resistors here are what are gonna set the current limit and the output voltage from our error amplifier circuit. So our output voltage just comes out over here. I'll label it V out. So here you can see we're creating positive feedback. And essentially what happens in this error amplifier is the positive feedback that gets created by this feedback loop is saturates the output from this amplifier. And that's what sets our output from our LDO circuit. So this is the central circuit that is used in an LDO. And obviously there are multiple variations of it. The important point here is really this error amplifier and this reference. So this reference voltage is normally just a silicon band gap reference circuit. I've never actually seen an LDO where you have a different type of reference voltage that's used. If you really wanted to, you could build one yourself. Just go get some off the shelf components and experiment with creating your own LDO. Next, what I actually want to do is look at what happens in certain situations when you use an LDO with different input and output voltages and how that affects the efficiency. And generally, the reason you use an LDO is because you're only giving up a little bit of that input power for heat and you want to get to as high as efficiency as possible, but you don't want to use a switching regulator. Switching regulators can be complex to design, they can be noisy. Because they're noisy, sometimes they require some isolation and they can be a real pain. So let's look at some actual parts and some actual data sheets and see what we can figure out. All right, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go to octapart.com and I'm gonna look up some actual components. Whenever you need to look up components, go to Octapart. They compile all the information from different distributors. They have all sorts of stuff in there that I didn't even know exists. Okay, so going to octapart.com, here's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna just search for LDO high voltage, just to kind of show an example of what happens when you run an LDO at too high voltage. And just looking in here, there's a whole bunch of options, all sorts of different manufacturers. In fact, there's 100 pages worth. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna look at a specific component, LDO or LT1086. So the LT1086 is a reasonably high current LDO. I think it can output up to about 3 amps at the right input. And it's generally a fixed output at about 3 volts. So it's actually selectable. So we'll look at the data sheet. Here what we have is, we can see all the important specs here. And when you're looking for actual components and you're looking for an LDO that you want to use, the first thing you want to look at is the dropout. So here, the first important spec is highlighted. I've highlighted it right here. It's operates down to 1 volt dropout. So when we say down to 1 volt dropout, what that's really saying is your input voltage needs to be at least about a volt larger than what you want as your output voltage. And then you can see here that there are different variants that output all these different voltage levels. So 2.85, 3.3, 3.6, all the other ones. So I mentioned in the previous video that if my input voltage gets really high, and my output voltage is regulated down to, you know, let's say 3.3 volts, what happens to the efficiency? Well, the efficiency does get really low, but there's something else that actually happens. I think that sometimes there's this idea that, well, I know that the efficiency gets really low, but I want to run my LDO at really high output current. And I can do that by turning up the input voltage, right? Well, that's not exactly correct. So there are a couple of reasons for that. First of all, remember, an LDO outputs at one of these fixed voltages. This is for this specific one. Different components will output at a different set of voltages, but in general, you're outputting at one of these voltage levels. And the whole point of the LDO is that it fixes that specific voltage level. Next, the current that you actually supply to your load is based on Ohm's law, and then whatever the maximum possible output current is. So here it's telling you the output current is 1.5 amps or 0.5 for this particular variant. So we'll not worry about the variant, but it's telling you what the output current is. And this is essentially your output current. So now if I actually scroll down to some of the graphs, what you'll see is that that output current rating is not actually the output current rating. The output current rating that you should really care about in your LDO is the short circuit current. So hold on a second, I just had it. Here we go. So the short circuit current, you can see in this graph. So here in this graph, I have on my y-axis the short circuit current in amps. And then on the x-axis, I have my input-output differential voltage. Really what this means is it's just the difference between whatever you're inputting and whatever you're outputting. And so you can already see where the dropout voltage level is. It's just about a volt. And so when this differential is 1 volt or less, you can see that the current drops down to zero, as it should. Next, each of these curves shows what the output current is for your input voltage at different temperatures. So what this is telling you is this is the maximum possible current you will ever be able to source from the LT1086 at each of these different temperatures. So here, this bottom curve is basically the minimum amount that the company that made the component can guarantee. They can guarantee a minimum of 1.5 amps of maximum output current at any temperature range. You can see all of these other temperature ranges lie above that. So let's look briefly at what happens now as we get to higher input-output differential. So as the input-output differential increases, eventually what happens is the short circuit current that you get out of the device actually goes down, and it eventually gets really low. And so this is showing you that you don't just get something for free by turning up your input voltage. If you turn up your input voltage, you're not going to increase the maximum output current. You're actually going to decrease it. And that's shown for all of these different curves. So it doesn't really matter what happens with temperature. And eventually it gets all the way down to several hundred, maybe a couple hundred milliamps at most. So this is really important. You can't just tune up your input voltage and expect to get a higher output current. So this is something really important to consider, because sometimes I think if you're new to LDOs, you'll have this idea that you can just plug in your, let's say, 25 volt input and step it down to 3 volts, and you won't have a problem. You'll be able to draw, let's say, the 1 amp of current you need. If you were to use this regulator in that situation, your voltage differential would be about 22 volts. So you'd be right about here on this circuit. You can see where my mouse is moving. And this would actually give you only maybe 100 or 200 milliamps of current, so not very useful. So you wouldn't be able to supply all the current that you need. Instead, what you would need to do is you would want to be able to bring down that input voltage level. So how would you do that? Well, you need another regulator, and this is where your buck regulator comes in, and you would want to put your buck regulator before your LDO. So that's actually a really common practice. So let's look at what else happens when you get to really high input-output differentials. One other thing that actually happens when you have different current outputs and you have different input-output differentials is the dropout voltage actually changes as well. So again, you want to try and get your input and your output to be very similar to each other in order to make sure that you have high efficiency. What this shows is that you can't get them too similar, right? In the previous video, we had mentioned that your output minus your input, input voltage minus your output voltage difference needs to be somewhere in the neighborhood of, you know, 0.7 volts. That's a little bit of an overgeneralization. You want to make sure that you look at these data sheets and find out what the actual dropout voltage should be for your temperature range and for the output current that you need. So here we can see that my minimum input output voltage differential, we can see that this line here across the screen is at 1 volt. Now, as I get to higher currents, as I get to say half an amp, that actually increases above 1 volt. And if I'm at a higher temperature range component, you can see that actually gets above about, that's 1.2 volts. So you need to be careful when choosing your voltage range when selecting these components. The voltage range that you need to work with should be above this minimum value for your component and the temperature range that you're working at. Now, this is important not necessarily for like DC powered inputs where maybe you're stepping down from like, you know, 5 volts down to 3.3 volts or something. You know, in that case, you'd be stepping down by 1.7. So you'd be up here on the graph instead of down here in these curves. But maybe you're working with like a battery. And so if you're working with a battery, the battery voltage could be 3.7 to start. Let's say, you know, it's a lithium ion battery. That could be 3.7 or something like this to start, but eventually that battery voltage is going to drop off as the battery life goes on and as the battery is used. And so that will eventually drop out. And what happens is you'll get below that minimum voltage differential limit before the battery actually burns out. So the device could turn off and the battery may not actually be dead. So consider that when you're selecting an LDO to power your components in your circuit board, because you want to make sure that the input power is always going to be above that minimum differential limit that you need to make sure that your board will operate before the battery life goes out. Okay, so when we were looking at the data sheets for the LT1086, I had mentioned that you can't just go from 25 volts, let's say, down to 3 volts and expect that you're going to get the full rated 1.5 amps or whichever current out of your LDO that you might expect. So there's a specific power regulation strategy that you should employ in order to do that. And so the typical way to do that is you'll have your, let's say, we'll use 25 volts as an example. You'll have your 25 volt input, and this needs to be stepped down to some value, and we're gonna step this down with a buck regulator. And this may step it down to, say, 5 volts. And then we can use our LDO and step this down to our 3 volts that we desire. So here, in this situation, this conversion efficiency could be somewhere in the neighborhood of 90%, let's say. Usually it's gonna be higher when you're dealing with these lower voltages and lower currents. And then here, depending on the current that you wanna pull out of this and this the differences between these two values, you can still have pretty high efficiency. And you can still get high current. So we have high E and we have high amps. So this is good. This is exactly what we want when we're running at 3 volts, and especially if we're dealing with a digital system that has a lot of components. We can generally pull a lot of current out of the LDO if we cascade from our input through a buck converter and then down to our final LDO. Usually what you do with this buck converter circuit is you'll have some sort of sensing circuit that goes to a controller. That controller then feeds back into the buck circuit. And so we'll talk more about this in the next video. But this feedback is actually really important because this input could be fluctuating. It could be just, you know, about 25 volts. So maybe it's 24, maybe it's 26, maybe it fluctuates over time. And if this fluctuates, this buck converter, if it's just running at stable conditions, will output something that also fluctuates, so it won't be exactly 5 volts. So do you want to put that stress back on the LDO so that the LDO has to do all the regulation? Well, I would say no. There's actually a more sophisticated way to do it, and it's a bit more of a difficult circuit to do if you have to build it all from scratch. But normally what you would do is you would take this, put it back into a controller, so the output would just be paralleled here, goes into a controller, and then that goes back into the input side of our buck converter. And so buck converter components actually have a feedback pin that they use. And so we'll go over that in the next video. So I've gone over this enough. Just remember that this is a good power regulation strategy to step down from a high voltage to an intermediate voltage, and then to your final lower voltage. All right, everybody, thanks for watching this video. If you need to build your next circuit board and implement a power regulation strategy like the stuff we've been talking about in these videos, get CircuitMaker. CircuitMaker is a great program for new designers who just want to learn about PCB design and electronics design, and who want a complete package of design tools to help them get started. It's also great because it gives you an introduction into the workflow that you'll use when you step up to a more advanced program like Altium Designer. That's all I have for today, and don't forget to call your fabricator.